Jaco. I can play the bass pretty good too.
Strap in, baby. We're coming home.
I was born in San Francisco, California, and living in San Francisco, you were exposed to all kinds of styles of music. I remember as a child basically being driven to grammar school by my mom, and there was a couple radio stations then, KYA and KFRC, and they played everything. You heard, it was a mixture of everything that was going on in the pop culture at that time. You know, you might hear Sinatra and a tune by the Beatles, a tune by the Supremes, or Diana Ross, and a new band that was coming out. There was no boundaries, and that's kind of like what was happening in San Francisco, basically, musically at this time. I started playing the drums when I was six. So it was 1964. And there was a program called the Ed Sullivan Show, and Ed used to like bring, he had a way of bringing what was going to be the next big thing. And so for me, it was watching, I think, the Beatles with my brother and mom. We watched the Beatles on the Ed Sullivan Show, and that just created, that created the whole thing for me to want to really play. You know, you're watching these guys playing, and girls are trying to jump over the fence to see him, and you know, they had long hair, and it looked pretty cool to do, you know? I mean, it was another way, you know, music, it just seemed that that was another way to go, and it really drew my attention, you know, because I just loved music without knowing I was going to play it. And then, you know, at the same time, I think the Stones were on Ed Sullivan, and so, you know, you saw Mick doing his thing, and, you know, the whole English thing kind of really, I think, influenced America big time, you know, for getting into music. Looking at it, you know, rock and roll or the fun part of it, that's what we saw. But we were kind of serious from the get-go. You know, my brother got a Kent guitar that he played as bass, and I got this little, like I said, little snare drum with a cymbal, and we started playing, and we tried to imitate, you know, what you heard from records back then, because that's the only way you could learn. You scratch the records, you learn, you see somebody on TV, you know. There's no YouTubes, and, you know, the information, the way we learned was completely different. You know, it was a much more rigorous way, you know, it was pure, you know, figure it out on your own. Yeah, so we started a band. It was called The Hallucinations. You know, we would take the 45s and put the little player here and on the floor tom-tom, put it up as loud as you could, so it was kind of like your monitor. And I can remember some of the very first ones that I really loved playing to over and over. And I can remember, like, it was the Stones, Ruby Tuesday, and Let's Spend the Night Together was a 45. And, you know, Charlie used to come in with this big, you know, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. So, you know, you learned how to do that right before they would sing Goodbye Ruby Tuesday, you know. And we played our very first concert for the mayor of San Francisco at that time when he was inaugurated, Mayor Alioto, at a club called Bimbo's 365 Club. Mr. Giantola, who was the man behind Bimbo's, his grandson played in our band, and he was in my brother's class. So we practiced in his garage. Well, this connection to have this nightclub owner and his grandson playing with us turned into be kind of like a seed that sprouted some incredible flowers in my career. So here I am, you know, in the fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh grades, and I'm listening to, there's Frank Sinatra, Dean Martin, my brother's got a picture with Duke Ellington, you know, I'm meeting the original Smokey Robinson and the Miracles, Mort Saul, Maury Amsterdam, all the old school comedians, Sammy Davis Jr. Then I meet Buddy Rich. My parents take me, I think, for my eighth birthday. And I'm in the front row, and they get me this big rum cake that has all these firecrackers coming out of it. And I'm sitting in front of Buddy Rich. I have no idea what to expect, man. You know, all of a sudden, Buddy Rich comes out and starts playing the drums. And I'm just saying, that's it. You know, that's something totally cool, you know, with the, whatever this guy's doing. So I can remember that night after the show, though, I went upstairs, met Buddy. He's in his Japanese kimono, you know, he's got his incense going, you know, he looks really cool. So he gives me a copy of the Big Swing Face, a pair of drumsticks, you know, and I'm in heaven. So, you know, I had this drum set at home, and my dad was cool. I got home, and I just ran downstairs, and I just started trying to imitate Buddy Rich, making lots of noise, you know. I mean, this guy was, you know, the most precise stick man that ever picked up a set of sticks, you know. It was beyond, it was like magic. So he let me go downstairs, and I rattled away for about half an hour. And I became friends with Buddy all the way up to his death. And he taught me a lot, and we talked a lot, and you know, he was very old school and talked to me about a lot when he played with, like, you know, Charlie Parker. And that era was so cool for me. We used to go to the pawn shops, and that was a big deal for us, you know, because, you know, we'd get our friends, my brother and the other guys, and you'd go downtown to, like, Skid Row, where all the pawn shops were, and that's where you'd see all these guitars and drums for sale, and you know, everybody who hawked their instruments, man, you know, to get some money to go have some fun, you know, or whatever. So my parents knew, I think, a guy who ran a pawn shop, Phil Siegel. And that's when, you know, we started getting our instruments, and I slowly but surely came up. And, you know, my parents saw my dedication or my love of the drums. And step by step, I've got a better set, you know, until one day I said, you know, could I get a Ludwig or something like that? And I got one, and God, that was a lot of drum sets ago. You had this promoter named Bill Graham, and Bill was this enlightened guy who just loved music. He didn't really have boundaries. He just said, forget the boundaries. I mean, you might see, 10 years after playing with the Buddy Rich Big Band, or Miles Davis with the Grateful Dead. I mean, B.B. King, Freddie King, Albert King on Tuesday night, you know, for $2. And so there was, you know, Santana playing as the Santana Blues Band on Tuesday nights. So you had all this stuff going on. You know, you'd be listening to everything from Johnny Cash to Miles to Coltrane to, you know, the Detroit thing, the Beach Boys. Everything was coming at you from every direction, because San Francisco was a city of taste. So whatever happened anywhere in the world, San Francisco was one of the places that it had to come to. So, you know, in that period in the 60s, San Francisco was the place, even more than New York. You know, San Francisco was the melting pot of transition. I think I'm about 16, 17 years old. Playing in the band at the time, the Beluga Whale, which was, again, one of the first San Francisco, you know, kind of new jam bands. I mean, we were way ahead of our time because we were already, you know, listening to Miles and Train and learning all the music of the Grateful Dead and the psychedelic bands of San Francisco and, you know, mixing country with rock and jazz and all that. But I'm always in the background. I'm listening to all the masters, you know. I'm listening to Elvin Jones, Tony Williams, Philly Joe, Buddy, Max Roach, you know, all the greats. I mean, because at that time, I used to go to a little store in the Tenderloin district of downtown called Drumland. And that's where you met up with, the serious drummers hung out at Drumland. That's when I met also Jerry Grinnelli, who became my teacher. And he was like one of the, you know, he was probably the pioneer of psychedelic beatnik drumming. You know, he was playing at the acid tests before even the Dead did. And he just, you know, turned me on to sound and shapes and colors. And, you know, drumming became this bigger thing than just drumming. It was music. It was sculpturing. It was making a piece of art. You know, every beat, every stroke, everything had a meaning. So you, when you watch Jerry play, it was like watching like Picasso draw or something. It was like, my God, what, these emotions and the expressions on his face and the connectedness to the music and the love of it. And that stuff rubs off on you. And, so, and every now and then something new really comes along that rattles the cage. So here I am going to this jazz club. I used to live there. I mean, it was like the Keystone Corner. And I mean, this was where you could hear all the greats and where I became good friends, like with Elvin Jones, who became like my mentor, teacher, and kind of like my guru. He blessed me when I was like 18 years old to be in the drum world with his presence. I met Max Roach and, you know, Blakey and Higgins and God, you name it. Just the list goes on and on and on. So, you know, you had this, all the jazz thing was coming on and you're all the rock stuff, you know, that you're listening to, you know, because the English guys were a really big influence on me to start with, you know, guys like Baker, Bonham, Keith Moon, Charlie Watts, Ringo, you know, all that whole school of the English drummers, you know, I think they blew everybody away. That was a pretty incredible time of music, to say the least. It's held its own big time. You know, and then you had all the stuff that was going in San Francisco. You had the psychedelic stuff, but you got to remember, we had the greatest funk drummers in the world coming from the Bay Area. You had like, you know, Sly and the Family Stone. They used to rehearse about 15 minutes from our house, you know, with Gregor Rico on drums. Then you had Tower of Power playing this unbelievable funk that came out of the James Brown School, and David Garibaldi, who's, you know, influenced everyone in funk drumming. And then you had the great Mike Clark, who was playing with Herbie Hancock and the Headhunters. I can remember one day I was at the bar with my dad, you know, and we were having a couple shots of vodka, and he looked at me and said, "Hey, the word is, man, that you can play pretty good." I said, "Really? Who told you that?" He said, "Yeah, but he says, I think you need to go on your own." I said, and I said, "Wow, you know, my dad's hearing some stuff on the streets, you know, because he had his ear to the streets, you know, guys, that's how you learn a lot of stuff in bars, man." And I said, "Yeah, I think it's time that I kind of move on." So I really wanted to go out and do my own thing in the jazz world, you know. And I was very influenced at that time, like by Art Blakey. He had his own band. Elvin had his own band. Tony Williams had his own band. You know, all these drummers were leading bands. I was going, "Hey, if they could do it, why can't I?" You know. So here goes nothing, you know. So, you know, it was a big move for me. You know, I always rolled the dice in my life. I've always been a gambler, literally. And this was a good roll again. And so I went on my own and started playing. And that's when I started, you know, that's when I met like even John Davis, the piano player.
I'd moved to the Bay Area in early 80s. I'd been living in Boston, went out to California, and started playing gigs in clubs around town. And I guess my earliest recollections of Brian were just sort of seeing him hanging out. He was always interested in meeting people that he thought he could connect with. He's always had a real just a very unusual quality and a sort of a rare sense and ability to just connect with people constantly, very, very fluidly. He was always, and comfortably, he was always just connecting, getting people together.
When I heard him play, it was like, damn, that's everything you could want out of a piano player. I could ask him to play any tune, any style, anything, and he knew it. And if he didn't know it, he'd learn it, you know. He just was one of those kind of musicians, you know. He was like myself. I mean, he was completely immersed in it. And we had a lot of the same background. He was from New York, I was from San Francisco. But, you know, when there's good music out there, it just kind of calls you, and you meet right in the middle somewhere.
I think we sort of complemented each other in that I was coming more from a standards tune background, Bill Evans Trio stuff, and Fred Hirsch, and more Miles repertoire and tunes, really. And Brian was coming a lot from the Train and Elvin and McCoy things. So I was getting him into sort of standard trio stuff, and he was always always wanting to expand everyone around him into what he was into. So that's it's always been sort of a very compatible and what's the word? Complementary, sort of a synergy, actually.
So, you know, we're playing and we're playing all kinds of stuff. We're learning all about the Chick Corea trios. Now he sings, now he sobs. All the Herbie trio stuff. And
at one point, I remember he went to Amsterdam with the idea that he just said, that's where you go to get record deals. And he must have been in 23 or 4, and I thought he was out of his mind. And he went to Amsterdam and he got a record deal with Timeless Records. I think he set his drums out on the streets of Amsterdam and he made a big impression.
I just remember all the reading about how all the New York guys and a lot of players were moving to Europe, you know, because the jazz scene and festivals, and it was much more open and kind to, you know, jazz. So I said, you know, again, let's roll the dice. And so we went to Amsterdam, and when I got there, I was completely blown away. Because you think it's going to be people with blonde hair and blue eyes and wooden shoes, and you get to Amsterdam and you go, God, this is pretty cool. You know, you can die any way you want to in Amsterdam. You know, Amsterdam's one of those places, you know, if you think you got some tricks up your sleeve, you might, Amsterdam can teach you a few things. Great city, one of my all-time favorites, and it was fantastic to me, you know. But when I got there, the staircases going up the hotel were like, you know, they were like 2 feet long and like going straight, so, you know, there's no elevator. So I couldn't bring my drums up to the hotel room. So I went and set my drums up under the concert square at Lights Plain. And I used to practice there like 8 hours a day, man, and come home with all this money. People would throw money in your bass drum top, man. I'd say, wow, this is great. You know, I'd come home and throw all this money on the bed, and we're rich, you know. The gamble paid off. You know, something always comes out of those chances. And so here's Todd in Amsterdam, and we meet up again. And my nickname in the old days was Whitey, and all my old friends know me as Whitey. And he'd say, hey, Whitey, do you know, maybe it's time for you to make your own record. And I said, God, it'd be great. He says, I think I can get you started here on Timeless Records. And I said, wow, cool. He said, listen, but I want you to have a guest, you know, I want to do you a favor. He goes, I know everyone in the jazz world. I said, He says, pick anybody you want to play with, anybody, I don't care who it is, and I'll get him to play on your record. And it didn't really take me long. I said, Jaco. He looked at me and said, I know Jaco, I'll call him.
Jaco playing with Joni Mitchell, that completely was incredible to me because, you know, you never heard the bass accompany the voice and music like this. I mean, it was just so big and beyond words. Even today, you know, you hear this, and it's just so gorgeous and so warm and so big. And, you know, he opened the doors for people to do different things, you know. And, you know, Jaco was, you know, he broke the doors down again, you know, and that really hadn't happened for a while, and especially in this style of music.
Phone rings at like 4 o'clock in the morning and my mom yells from the back room, "Hey Brian, you know, somebody's on the phone for you. Who's calling at this hour?" I don't know. I said, "Who is he?" He goes, "Some guy named Jocko's on the phone." I said, "Boy." So I ran back into the room and said, "Mom, just, it's gonna be okay. Just let me take this call." And so I said, "Hello." And he goes, "Hey, is this Brian Melvin?" I said, "Yeah." He says, "This is Jaco Pastorius, the world's greatest bass player. I hear you're making a record." I said, "Yeah, I'm trying to get this together." He says, "You need a bass player?" I said, "I'd love one." He says, "Put me on a plane now." So he says, "You know, I'm going to call you back in an hour to get my plane info." And I said, "Cool, call me back." So he hangs up. So I said, "Hey, Mom, you got to do me this favor. I need your credit card." You know, trust me, you know, it's going to be cool. This is like the greatest cat in the world that wants to play, and it's a dream of mine, you know. And, you know, moms know when it's the right time to do something. So she said, "Okay, I'll help you out." And so, you know, I think, you know, I just called an airline, I don't know, back then, it was a long time ago, and said, you know, book him his ticket and blah, 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 and blah, blah, blah. And he called back, gave him his info. So I was really, like, you know, desperately waiting for his arrival to come, and he didn't make the first plane. Right, and I said, "Oh, damn, don't tell me this guy's just, you know, joking me or whatever, you know, you're like a, you know, sad little kid now, you know." So then he calls up and says, "Man, I'm sorry, man, you know, blah, 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 I'll be on the next one." And he got on the next one. So I can remember, man, he comes off the plane, and all he had, man, was like, he had a pair of like yoga pants on, no shoes, you know, like a African shirt, headband, and a little plastic bag with his thongs and a book. He was reading Frankenstein. And it was cool, you know. It was like, man, this guy travels light, you know. And he looked a bit tired and like he was hanging out and stuff. And so I said, "Come on, let's go home and let's go eat and I'll show you around the pad." And this is when a beautiful friendship started right from the beginning, you know. He comes home, you know, my dad has just passed away, you know, maybe a month, 2 months before, and comes home, I introduce him to my mom, my brother, and my girlfriend at the time. And he was really cool, he was just tired. And my mom is this old-fashioned Italian lady, you know, pretty strong, you know. And her and Jaco hit it off, like, fantastic, man. Like, right from the get-go, there was this incredible bond between them, almost like a mother-son thing, you know, and it was really cool to see the respect that, you know, Jaco would give my mom right from the beginning. And it really made everything kind of comfortable. And so for the first week, man, he just stayed in his room. And he'd only come out to eat. He was very quiet. And for that whole week, he just read the Bible. And was getting his spirit and his health, and, you know, he wanted to feel real good, you know, because, you know, he was a sportster, you know, he was a sports guy. That's how he got his name Jaco, you know, and that's another thing that became a very close bond between us was all the stuff that we had in common besides music. I had a band called Night Food. And the name actually came when me and Todd were driving around in Amsterdam one night, and I looked at Todd and I said, "Let's go get a little Night Food." And Todd looked at me and said, "Wow, that's a great name." So Night Food kind of became our you know, the title for the band and a few records. So after about a week, he came out and was really happy. He said, time to hit, let's play. And, you know, it was great because, you know, then I said, okay. And in the meantime, I had to pick some guys to play with, but John was the first cat. You know, it's like, I already got the piano player. We're cool, you know, if we want to play some trio, this guy knows everything.
Brian has always had this ability to just get to people that were intriguing to him. He'd been doing it his whole life. I mean, he did it when he was, long before I met him, you know, he'd had all these encounters that seemed unbelievable to me. And then after I got to know him for a while, I realized this is how this guy is. And he used to say, I'd really like to get Jaco on my records. And I said, well, yeah, who wouldn't? And I don't exactly know, but the next thing he was saying, man, you gotta meet us at this studio, some loft type studio. Jaco's gonna be there, we're gonna do a session. And I honestly didn't take him seriously, and I didn't go. I really didn't go. And he called me the next day, he says, man, you should have showed up. Jaco was there, we had a great time. Next thing you know was we're learning a bunch of Jaco's material. At the same time, he's learning tunes I've written because I've got to present something for my first record. And so the very first record we made, we recorded it at this place called Poolside Studios. And it was in this basement of a house. You know, I felt a little strange. You know, I got the greatest bass player in the world, and I'm pulling up to this studio where you have to open the garage door. And you go in, and these guys made a studio in the basement of where they were living. But it was, everybody was cool, and Jaco was still cool. He was like, you know, he never played an attitude of like, I'm up here and you're down there. He just wanted to be treated with respect and love, and you know, and so we started to make the record there, and things were rolling. I mean, it was actually happening. You know, you kind of had to slap yourself, going, "Man, we're making the record. It's actually, you know, tracks are being laid down, and they sound pretty darn good. And he's taking it serious." John around, it was just about music. And Jaco was a drummer before he played bass, you know, and before he broke his hand or wrist. And so with my background of knowing all the jazz stuff, you know, and he loved that, you know, Philly Joe and Max and Art. And he used to call me Mr. Swing, you know, because I was really I knew the history of jazz drumming. And his father, Jack, bless his heart, was also a jazz drummer and a singer, and came up with that, you know, kind of old school jazz stuff.
So there was this connection again happening, you know, of that. Jaco would show me some really cool stuff on the drums. You know, he had this whole, he used to call it Floridian. Yeah, here's some stuff from the swamp, you know, and he played these really cool kind of funk beats, you know, and that ended up being in Weather Report and his music and influenced me and a lot of people, you know. I mean, he was a great drummer, you know, and it was a real lot of fun too. So we'd share all kind of drum stuff with each other.
For months at a time, we were having some very nice, even-keeled times in San Francisco, and I think Jaco appreciated it, and Brian's mother was actually taking care of him, kind of like just a kid. It was really something.
You know, my mom came from a big family and had some brothers, and, you know, she wasn't going to take no guff from some, just because a guy had a big name. She didn't care. You know, you're in my house, be cool. You know, that's how it was, and he understood that. And he loved her, and they used to dance, and he loved her cooking, and, you know, she took great care of him and watched over him and made sure that the right people were around, you know, and she was real cool about that. So they became close, and, you know, all the way up to the end, they used to call each other. You know, Jaco would call, and his dad, too, would always call to check in on my mom, and, you know, his dad knew that he was in good hands. So a period went by, we're all playing, I'm doing this, doing some tours, everybody's doing some different stuff, and all of a sudden, you know, Wim Witt, again from Timeless Records, says, you know, do you want to put a tour together in Europe?
We're going to my mama's country. Suomi, S-U-O-M-I, Suomi. That's how you say Finland.
I said, sure, and I called Jaco. I said, man, Jaco, man, you know, would you do this tour with me? You know, that was a big question to ask him. I was really scared to ask him that. Making a record, yeah, studio dates, cool, but then you're asking this guy, you know, will he play bass in your band? And he said, I'll do it for you, Brian.
1985, and it was the first time I had gone to Europe, and that was something.
He was a master of creating controversy. He was beautiful at PR. So he refused to get on like the plane. And we would say, why? And you know, he said, tell the promoter I want more money. You know, it was like, you know, he played every card he could, you know. So, you know, we got that all worked out. But the funny part about that was that the guitar player, Paul, didn't know that. So Jaco got on the plane, but then ran off the plane. So we all chased Jaco off the plane, but the guitar player still's got his headphones on, he's listening to some music, and he didn't get off the plane. So he took off not knowing that we're not on the plane. So eventually somewhere he realizes, man, where's the band? So he ends up somewhere in Germany waiting for us. So we got on the next plane and made it. That was kind of like how the tour started. We're in the limo. And we're starting to drive through town, and Jaco says, hey, Brian, man, look at that, man. And I said, what? I said, man, you know, it's these huge posters, and it's Jocko's face picture. And he goes, man, they're, you know, I said, man, I told this guy, you know, here he is selling my band through Jaco. And this was like the beginning of like some weirdness. At the top, it says Brian Melvin's Night Food, really small, and then featuring Jaco, you know. He's just telling Jocko's name, and that's when Jaco said, okay, we got to teach this guy a lesson. So I think we played that night, and Jaco said, okay. He started thinking like you know, he was like kind of like a general in the army or something, man. He was saying, tonight we're going to perform the worst concert ever. I said, said, what do you mean? He goes, everybody's going to play a different instrument. And man, it was crazy. I think, man, everybody played an instrument they couldn't play. And we go out and we're trying to play music, if you can imagine that. Then, the people are just like not digging it at all. I think it was written up in the paper as Sweden's worst jazz concert ever. You know, so Jocko's accomplishing exactly what he wanted. You know, he's like saying, you're going to do this to Brian, and you're going to put my pictures on the poster and not treat him with the respect that we asked you to do. Well, then here it comes. So, you know, he started saying, okay, we're going to do a good concert tonight. Here we're going here. I like this city. These people have been cool to me. We're going to blah, blah, blah. And it was a really good band. It was like Azar Lawrence on sax, John Davis, you know, on keyboards, Jaco, Paul Musavi on guitar, and myself. And we had a kind of a cool repertoire worked out of my tunes, Jaco, you know, tunes he liked to play, you know, Shot the Sheriff, some Marley stuff, or, you know, all kinds of cool stuff. So it was fun. I think we're in Paris, and we're going to play the New Morning. And he wasn't in a really good mood. He was like just kind of not digging a lot of things, you know, and there was things going on back home with his family, and he was going through a divorce, and so consciously, you know, just spiritually, you could just tell things were affecting him from the outside. And I didn't understand it as much as I understand it now, you know, how that can really affect someone in every possible way of their being. So we got to Paris at the New Morning, and something happened with him and the owner, this lady, and he didn't do, I don't know, he might have spat on her or did something really weird to her. And me and Jaco got into a confrontation, you know, one thing led to another, you know, I think I knocked him out, you know, and he's on the floor crying, and, you know, and then all of a sudden he says, I'm not playing anymore with you, and I said, okay, I don't care, send me home. So the next thing you know, it was like mutiny on the Bounty. I got kicked out of my own band, you know, you know, it's like, you gotta go, and I called home and said, I'm coming home, and what about the other guys? Well, the other guys, at the time I was kind of a little disappointed, but I understand them now. I mean, they wanted to play with Jaco and the tour and on, and, you know, it was about making some money and, you know, a living and all that. So some time went by, and I get a call from Jaco. I don't know, 6 months, 7 months, a year later. And he says, let's play, man. I want to do something with you and John again. And I said, cool. You know, and he says, man, I'm really sorry. What happened just happened, and let's move on, you know. And, you know, I believe in compassion. I believe in forgiveness for, you know, I mean, God, I've been forgiven many times. So, I mean, you know, that's part of the deal. And I just said, okay, let's do it. So he came out to San Francisco again. And this was an interesting period, because this is leading up to the Standard Zone trio date with John, which, you know, became a historic, and still is, you know, one of Jaco's only, you know, piano trio dates he ever did. And it was his dad's favorite record.
I run into somebody who tells me they grew up on the Standard Zone record, the trio record, Brian's trio we did. And it's, you know, it never lessens almost, which is amazing. People still introduce me as other people, as the guy that played with Jaco. You know, it's years and years ago, but it's such a defining experience.
John said, man, Brian, we really got to get in the studio as a trio, because we were practicing as a trio most of the time at my house. And I had this beautiful Steinway still there, and Jaco would show John all the original voicings. Jaco was a darn good piano player, you know. I mean, forget bass playing. He was one of the great modern writers. Composition, man. And, you know, composition is different than playing. And so John, like, had these huge hands, you know, I mean, because Jaco could bend his, had these double jointed thumbs. So Jaco could, like, you know, reach his thumb over here. But John had these big hands, and Jaco said, man, you're the only guy that can play my chords right, you know, because John said, yeah, you know. And so that was kind of fun. So we had fun. And so John learned a bunch of stuff firsthand, you know, and when you're learning it from the horse's mouth, man, it's pretty cool.
Downstairs, that had an old, I guess it still does, an old Steinway upright. And we spent hours and hours and hours just shedding in there. It was really amazing. Jaco was showing me really the chords to all his songs, John and Mary and Three Views and Dania. And we used to do all our shedding in this little practice room in Brian's house. They were something very special. The balloon song, a series of 12 tone rows. We methodically went through that. So they were formative for me and very special time.
Then we did a bunch of gigs, man, like in little places like the Stork Club and all these odd little places, because Jaco said, let's just play some gigs, man. Forget about the bread. Let's just play. So that was easy. Hey, call up a club and say, listen, man, you know, I got a trio with Jaco Pastorius. This is cool. And, yeah, when do you want to play? So we got to kind of like arrange our own dates. And then we hooked up in this place in Marin called The Dock with some incredible concerts, actually, we played there.
After the gig, I think Jaco was feeling pretty good. And he would act like a leprechaun sometimes. He'd have his hat pulled down almost over his eyes and he'd sort of be bouncing around. So we were outside and it was very quaint and these, you know, very sort of upscale, quaint neighborhoods in Sausalito. And the police cars sort of parol around, just keeping an eye on things, these little winding roads. And one was sort of purring along and Jaco was hiding behind the bushes. And right as the cop car was coming up, Jaco jumped out of the bushes and he landed in front of the cop car. And they're sort of shocked, but he didn't look dangerous, but he kind of looked out of his mind. And they stopped and they get out of the car and Jaco points at me and he says, arrest him. He played the melody to The Sophisticated Lady wrong.
These guys that ran the club said, is it cool, man, if we record you guys? And, you know, I promise we never do anything with them and I'll get you a copy. And I said, sure, man, you know, go ahead, you know. And so years went by. The next thing I know, man, here comes this record called Curtain Call, live from the dock, you know. And I couldn't believe it, man, that these guys, like, would put this CD out without even asking, you know, Jocko's estate or me or John or anything, just like, you know, and I kind of tracked them down and, you know, it was really shady. This was when we made the record Night Food, the second one, but this was featuring Bob Weir of the Grateful Dead, Jaco, Merle Saunders, you know, and John was there, you know. John started his recording career with me together, you know.
In a short amount of time, we were doing gigs with Jaco, Joe Henderson, Bob Weir, lead singer from the Dead, And thinking back on it, it was very interesting because Brian was ahead of the curve a little bit. I didn't realize that as much until I got back to New York and there was this whole thing, this whole acid jazz thing going on. And I kept on thinking to myself, wow, that's what Night Food was. You know, in 1983, we were playing Monk and Miles and Train Tunes with these little funk beats and, you know, really stretching them out. And I used to say, Brian, no, you can't do that to these Monk tunes, man. You got to swing. He said, no, man. We're gonna funk them, you know, because he's from California, so he was into all those Oakland bands, you know, Tower Power and all that stuff. And he had a real sense of where stuff was going. It was really very interesting.
And so it was a great record, you know. It was. All the tracks were full of emotion, really good quality, and Bob sang Mercy, Mercy, written by Joe Zawinul, so that was kind of cool to have a Joe Zawinul tune sung by Bob Weir of the Grateful Dead with Jaco playing bass, you know. So it was kind of like this Grateful Dead and Weather Report connection, which I was very proud of, that kind of, they were two of my favorite bands of all time, and here it is happening in some weird way, you know. So we did some shows together that were fantastic, you know, with Bob, Jaco, and the band. And we had Little John Crisley on harmonica, and, you know, it was really fun, really great. And a couple of those shows, Hiram Bullock came out and sat in with us. And there would always be somewhat of Jocko's friends out there that wanted to come by, sit in, and say hello. And so that was really fun. So there was that little phase, you know. When he came to stay with me that time, you know, I said, hey, look at me, let's go by Yorma's house. He lives right up here, you know, because Jaco's mom was, you know, she has Finnish background. And so Yorma's from Finland. And so there's this really strange, all these really crazy connections, because Jaco loves San Francisco. And his mother lived there, I think, as a young woman. So there was this kind of thing about San Francisco that was surrounding him, and or why did his mom love it, you know, there's that kind of a thing. And so we went up to Yorma's house and knocked on the door, but no one was there, man. But the door was open, so Jocko walked in and was looking around. I'm going, damn, man, no one's here. We're in Yorma's house. You know, he probably wouldn't dig this, you know. But he looked around and said, hey, are you home? And we looked around and tried to make that connection. And so I put I put Yorma and Jocko together. That ended up becoming a thing in New York. And we played some shows in New York, which was incredible, with Jaco on bass, Yorma played guitar, Rashid Ali, who, you know, great drummer that played with John Coltrane, myself, we had two drummers, and I played some percussion. That was the basis of the band, and every now and then Yorma or Jaco would add somebody to play with us, and, you know, it was all surrounded around the blues, because, you know, Rashid came up on the blues, you had Yorma, who was, you know, this great blues picker, like from Reverend Gary Davis, you know, style and electric blues. And Jaco came up playing a lot of blues and funk, and I liked the blues. And so we did some shows and we did that. That was another phase. And that only happened in the New York area for me. And I think they continued to do some other tours and projects together themselves. There was no drug problem. See, that was a thing that was, not with us. That's what I'm saying. I don't know what he did with other people, man. You know, and that wasn't my business, you know, but, you know, we played basketball, went to the beach, man, ate good food, learned music. At this phase, so we're at this phase now, and, you know, he'd have a couple beers maybe at the gig. You know, he might do a bump. You know, and feel good, whatever. But it was nothing like, you know, he didn't have to be any, I didn't have, it was cool. It was easy. There was no problem. Now, what happened with other people, I couldn't tell you. You'd have to go ask them. But our thing was really, really, it was quite tame, to tell you the truth, man. It was just about having a good time, you know, a natural good time. He was very much into homeopathic medicine, you know. He was very much into healing. He loved nature, he loved the water, he loved the sun. You know, he was a healer. You could hear it in his music. You don't play like that, man, without being a healer, man. He was like a modern day shaman. He was a shaman. You know, he was teaching the world of the possibilities of life through music. So that's why he had friends from all walks of life, just like myself. So we had this in common. And like the sports thing really bonded us, because he took pride and being a good basketball player. But I was really good also as a kid and was on the all-star teams. He used to get mad because he could never beat me. And he used to get so pissed he'd start throwing the balls at me at the court. Because I took pride, I said, hey, one thing, you know, I'll never play like you, but you're not gonna get me on the court. And that used to piss him off to no end, man. And we laughed and, you know, we'd bet for dinner or lunch. And so, you know, we had a blast playing sports. I don't think he did that with a lot of his other friends at that time.
Thank you.
Then I got a call that, you know, I heard something happen, or, you know, panic. There was panic in the family or something, and they had him committed to Bellevue Hospital in New York, a psychiatric unit. And I think he was doing some peculiar things, again, maybe in New York, or, you know, he kind of probably scared people. You know, he had a way of, you know, he could scare you if he wanted to. You know, like the rules were set. You know, like, I had a lot of friends. Some of my best friends were Hell's Angels and still are. My brother is kind of like a big guy. You know, it's like, you know, Jaco sees what's happening around us. He kind of liked that, too, because he loved motorcycles. And we love motorcycles. And so, you know, you have a... He knows my background of who my street friends were. So, you know, there was going to be no funny stuff like that. We didn't tolerate that stuff. And I still don't tolerate that stuff. So me and my friend go out to New York. And I go up to Bellevue on the 19th floor, and, you know, he didn't belong there, man. And I understand, you know, look, you know, that maybe the family, you know, maybe for them everything hit the fan. You know, there was nowhere else to do. There's nothing else we try to, you know, but I come from the healing arts. I've been doing Tai Chi and healing and Qigong since I was a little boy. And most things that I found out in life are based on love. Usually when you bring it down to its common point, it's something about something with love. And I think in their family, because I was never really close to anybody in their family, and I'm still not. It was never like that. It was like me, my family, and our relationship with Jaco and his dad. I met his other family after he passed on. But the interesting thing was when I walked up there, I looked at my buddy Paul and I said, "He don't belong here, man." You know, you just, the vibe was like, you know, this was more like out of panic, I think, and fear. You know, let's put him in here, you know, and, you know, let's get him on lithium or Tegretol. And, you know, and I was going, well, what's going on, man? This ain't the way you heal someone, you know. Let's put a Band-Aid on it. That doesn't work. So I said, you know, I'll sign for him, man. You know, come live with me, man. You know, come with me and my mom and family, and, you know, we'll take care of you, man. You know, you don't have to play music. You don't got to do nothing. Just chill out, you know. At this time, his family and everybody kind of gave up taking the phone calls, and they thought he was in the right place, man. You know, we got him in a psychiatric ward. Everything's going to be great. And I'm like saying, you guys really don't understand this, man. Like, I signed. He came out to San Francisco. And, you know, looking, you know, one of the problems that Jaco had, to me, just my opinion, was his relationship with women. You know, here you are, the really great-looking dude, man. You're the best bass player in the world. You're on every magazine. Everybody's checking you out. Everybody wants to play with you. Hey, man, you know, the odds of you keeping a relationship are not too high. You know what I'm saying, man? So, you know, he loved his kids, man. You know, he used to just cry talking about his children. He'd call them up, and you could see the love and the heart, man, you know, that he had for his children. But he knew he just couldn't keep it together with the women. Things that didn't work out relationship-wise. And I think that kind of saddened him, because, you know, he wanted to be that old school maybe type of father and parent, but it couldn't really happen organically in his environment. You know, what he created around him is quite difficult. And again, I don't know enough about the background to comment, but that was what I saw in my period of knowing him. Yeah. he invited his girlfriend at the time to come stay with us in San Francisco. And we didn't really embrace it because we kind of heard, you know, some stories about it. But we said, okay, bring her out. And slowly but surely, I start seeing, here comes the weird stuff again, you know. And the next thing you know, you start hearing the fighting downstairs or the, you know, we're at a gig and, you know, he'd come off playing a great thing and, you know, what'd you want? Did you want that chick in the second row? And Jock was like, oh God, you know, it's like, next thing you know, it's fighting, you know, and it, just commotion. And so it just got to the point where you're like, my mom said, man, she got to go. And so, you know, at that point, he just followed her. You know, because I mean, it was kind of like that, you know, again, it was a relationship built on, I don't know, you know, dependency in some weird kind of psych, you know, twisted way. And, you know, he was just going to be with her. No, but like I said, he loved humor. I remember this, though. I remember like the first time, a couple times he'd come in and stay in the back room, and we both loved Johnny Carson. And man, you know, our doors would be closed in our rooms. We would hear each other laugh at the same stuff. Just, he would just bust up every night about Carson, right?
In Europe, it was it had the makings of an interesting night. He had borrowed money, I believe, from his roadie. And with that money, he bought me a keyboard. And he gave the keyboard to me so we could start learning some of his music on the road. And he bought me a book of Bach inventions, and he literally gave me this keyboard as a present with money that he borrowed from his roadie. And then he proceeded to call everybody in the band in the hotel and have them bring their mini-mart refrigerators to my hotel room. So by the morning, there were about 8 refrigerators in my room, and everything in them had been drunk. And that morning, the chambermaid comes and knocks on my door, and she wants to do a count on what I've had in my mini mart. And I turn around and I look in the room, and there's 8 of them open with glasses everywhere. And I always thought that was something.
So, you know, his dad, Jack, was this, you know, tremendous kind of funny guy. And like I said, he reminded you of, like, to me, Bob Hope and that whole Don Rickles, Jack Benny kind of old school stuff that, like, my dad kind of came up with. And he would always call and check in and say, you know, who loves you, man? And, you know, blah, blah, blah. And that record's great. And, you know, he had a way of just, you know, making you feel good. And, you know, God bless his soul. So many people have asked me this and asked me that, and what was he like, and was this true, was that true? And all in all, man, he was very soulful, really cool, loved life, loved music, loved humor, loved all the great things. And I think, you know, the thing where it came in with the bipolar thing and, you know, the crazy stuff, you know, I'm sure, you know, there was part of that, but that wasn't the thing that... you know, I saw as being, you know, the problem. The problem was, like I still say, was the relationship, I think, with women in his life, you know. And maybe, you know, someday they can talk to, you know, his wives or his ex-girlfriends and stuff like that. Because, you know, that wasn't easy for him. I can tell you some, you know, one night we were in France playing, and you know, he gets a call, you know, like from his second wife, Ingrid, and you know, the divorce went through, and man, you know, this just, he took a plate and threw it in the air and cut his finger. He couldn't play. We were supposed to go on stage, man. He went out to try to do a bass solo, man, and you know, he had bandages on his finger, man, and he couldn't do it, and he tried, and you know, he just started crying because, like, you know, so much emotions at one time. I just remember, like, the French started stomping their feet saying, reimbursement, reimbursement. And, you know, Jaco just walked up to him on the microphone, man. And he goes, he puts up both hands and goes, you French live in hell. And the next thing I know is I look at John and I look at everybody and go, whoa. You know, they're starting to come towards the stage and stomping their feet. And I said, man, the guy's the promoter grabbed us. We got in a limousine and, you know, we got out of there. You know, that was a close call that night. You started seeing a little bit of this, you know, kind of verbal assault. We started seeing little bits of verbal assault to other people. And the way I, you know, I'm sure we've all done it, but his started to get a little bit more common. And so when you started hearing stories about him, you know, this or that or this or that, you know, I said, okay, you know, it's, you know, it's par for the course. It kind of sounds, you know, in that direction. And I think that, you know, if I had to, you know, make a bet, you know, even concerning maybe, you know, concerning his death, I wouldn't doubt it if something dramatic was said to, you know, this person. This was one of your dear buddies and that came into your life, and you know, he's your bro, you know, like I always had his back, man, and he knew that, you know, whether we were out at a club or playing, you know, I had his back, and he knew that and he liked that. And you know, then after that, you know, I put a benefit on for his kids in the Bay Area. And everybody came to play, you know. I called, it was really cool, you know what I mean? Santana, Herbie Hancock, Peter Erskine, Wayne Shorter, Nardo Michael Walden, I mean, Bob Weir, my bands played, Night Food, the John Davis, and we had a Jaco Pastorius Memorial Sextet, which played all his tunes. And there was just all this love and outpouring, you know, and my goal was I wanted to make his kids some money, you know, basically, you know, and that was my goal, just to put on a concert and put some money in their accounts as a trust fund. And now I think some of the kids are playing and recording and they're all grown up. And I never had a close relationship with any of them, you know. We had a very distant thing. Like, they probably never understood, you know, why Jaco's in San Francisco, why me? You know, this is God stuff, man. It's not about why, you know. You don't answer that easily, you know. There's a bigger picture than, you know, this little stuff, you know. And, you know, he loved his kids. He loved everyone. You don't marry someone. You don't have kids. You don't create people without love. And, you know, like that song, everybody needs somebody to love. You know, that's what it is. It's a love thing. And sometimes love grows and sometimes it never dies, man. It just floats in the invisible world, you know. And, you know, I'm sure if you got everybody together in the room, everybody would say, hey, yeah, I mean, we were all lucky to have a relationship with this great man. Sure, he had some wild sides to him. You know, he was a rebel with a cause, you know. One of the things I really respected about him was of the way I can remember one time we played a gig in Thanksgiving and he went and bought 30 turkeys, man, and went and gave them to all the homeless people, you know, after the gig. Stuff like that. You know, you hear stories where he'd swim out and kiss the Statue of Liberty, man, on July 4th, and come back and play a concert for the homeless cats in the park. You know, he'd give his money away to people. You know, he was teaching on such a different level. If you really understood the message, it was like, man, don't get too attached to anything. It's not yours, it's God's. He loved Jesus, he loved Hendrix, man, he loved Parker, he loved Bach. You know, he was also showing that it's bigger than just, you know, becoming this famous bass player, musician, and that's it, you know, and there was a message there. And I think the message was still about love and about life and, you know, trying to do the best you can and work through it.
What struck me initially about Jaco playing with him was, I guess not surprisingly, just how inside the music he just wanted to treat it. I mean, there would be times, you know, depending upon various things, where there might be some, you know, dramatic ego-like behavior, but that was not the norm at all. The norm was really practicing, talking about the music. He was actually very respectful. He used to call me his third favorite piano player, which I still take quite to heart, because the first two were Joe Zawinul and Herbie Hancock. So I thought number three on that list was not a bad place to be. So it was kind of fun, but he was very supportive.
I just feel very proud, very honored to have been his friend and to make music with him, to record, to have him live in my house, share meals with my family. You know, it was different, you know, for us, because probably with a lot of other cats, man, you know, he played with or did gigs and whatever. But there wasn't that many cats, man, where he lived with or took him out of Bellevue and took care of him, because, you know, I loved him. We loved him, man. It was about love, nothing else, you know.
Sort of experience with being connected with the whole Jaco history and record. It's as I've been thinking about this to do this taping, it's really occurred to me once again how sort of underlying the whole experience has been.
Jaco's music, you know, was so important and so cool in the sense that it broke down all the barriers of you know, race, let's say. You know, to just his acceptance from everyone. You know, it was colorblind. I mean, nobody I ever heard had a bad word to say about his music or didn't like the way he played. You know, it was almost impossible because it was so beautiful and pure and new and fresh and thoughtful.
Above all else, he was really a melodic, just into the melody, into the words, into the melody. You know, he was sort of into the basics, you could really say, you know, more than all the fast stuff and all the harmonics. He really liked the melody and the groove and the time. So he tried to have me arrested for playing the bridge to Sophisticated Lady wrong, and I learned the bridge subsequently. Thank you.
Rise to the occasion, but it was like his writing was something that just was incredible. You know, I think when he wrote Teen Town, that just blew everyone off the map. You know, to this day, everywhere I go, you know, you play with Jaco, bass players start playing Teen Town and try to play Teen Town. And, you know, but just that whole idea of what he was doing was just unbelievable. You never heard anything like that, you know? I mean, and you haven't since. It's just, you know, one of those things in history that was captured at a, you know, was just meant to happen at this time, and thank God it did. It was just really, really cool music.
Feels like the time is right to sort of revisit the whole connection and do a project, sort of phase two of the Standard Zone thing.
Even some of the projects I did later, even recently, you know, my project with Beetlejazz with my good friend and co-leader Dave Kukoski on piano. But when you look at what we did, you know, Jaco had a big influence on this too, because he was a huge Beatle fan. You know, he loved McCartney and Lennon and the writing of the Beatles. And we used to talk about that a lot, you know, because that's one of the main influences on me getting into music was the Beatles. But all the people that like were playing and some of the guests, you know, Toots Thielsman and Michael Brecker, Mike Stern, Randy Brecker, I think Richard Bona, Larry Grenadier played on it, you know, Joe Lovano, you know, just lots of John Schofield, and all these people had some kind of interaction with Jaco, whether they played with him or knew him or hung out with him. So, you know, I always felt when we were recording Beetlejazz, we were doing it, that he was in spirit right there and really kind of throwing a little dust on our project.
We'll be right back.
I think we made great music. I think the records are fantastic. They were all done with very clearness and consciousness and rehearsal and, you know, it wasn't any funny, there was no funny business. He left some great music, great compositions, you know, his kids are playing, keeping the tradition going. Hopefully, you know, this film will inspire people and try to, you know, see him in a different light. Like I said, when you hear Jaco play, the stuff he did with Joni Mitchell and Weather Report and all these different people and his own records, I mean, he was a brilliant, warm-hearted man that was conscious of the big picture. You know, there's a lot of questions that can't be answered, you know, and that's not up to us to answer all the questions, but I think to hold the man and a high esteem and high light with, you know, full of love and full of heart is what we'll all do and what I've tried to do. And, you know, like I said, I'm just very proud and honored to still be here to share, you know, this little bit of my life with Jaco.
Mm-hmm.